അമരാമാ ഹരേ ഹരേ. ഹരേ കൃഷ്ണ. I'm honored to be here amongst all of you today, and I'll speak on the topic of how the Bhagavad Gita offers us love through both light and warmth, and how we can also offer similar love to each other. How Srila Prabhupada offered that love, and how the festival of lights that is going to come now also offers something similar. So broadly, so I'll talk especially in this last part of the Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna has more or less concluded his instructions and then he is giving the final words. So we can envision four quadrants. When we relate with each other, we can have, say, one side, one axis is light, the other is warmth. Light means where we show people the way. This is right, this is wrong. We give them the light to see things. Warmth is where we offer affection, encouragement, kindness. So the four quadrants could be no light, no warmth. Light but no warmth. Warmth but no light. And light and warmth. So so let's look at these four quadrants. No light and no warmth is a place of misery, loneliness and helplessness. Now if we don't know what to do, and if we feel that no one cares for us, no one values us, that whether I live or die, nothing matters, then it's a very, very dehumanizing and distressing state to be in. And unfortunately, many people live in that state where they're just blinded, not because they can't see, but because they have too much to see. It's like if you have too many options in life, then it's blinding. Say if we are sick and if we go to a doctor, and so the doctor, instead of prescribing some medication, says you have got these symptoms, and these five symptoms can mean this disease, and this disease you can have these five treatments, and these are the possible, these are the cost, these are the consequences, these are side effects, and this treatment, these are the things. So like that, the doctor gives us 25 options, and then the doctor says, choose, what do you want to do? We would be blinded by freedom, burdened by freedom. What do we do? How do we know? So if we are in that position of no light, no warmth, that is a very distressing state to be in. We need to get out of that. In one sense, at the start of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna was in that situation. Arjuna was physically and symbolically in no man's land. Initially he had said, Senayor Ubhayor Madhye Ratham Sthapayame Achyuta. He said that, please, O Krishna, place me in the middle of the two armies. When he said that, please place me in the middle of the two armies, that means he's neither here nor there. So he is in the middle. In the middle means you're vulnerable to the attacks by both. Of course, the Pandavas would not attack him, but he had come in the middle to see objectively. And when that happened, he was alone. And then he became confused. What should I do? And that warrior, who could not be defeated by anyone else, became defeated by his own confusion. And he put aside his bow, saying, I can't fight. Visrujya sasharam chapam shokasam vignamanasaha. He put aside his bow. The Bhagavad Gita is a historical book, but it is much more than a historical book. It is also eternal, and it represents eternal principles of living. So Arjuna's bow represents our determination. We may not have to fight physical battles, but we also have to fight in life against adversities, against adverse situations. And when you have to fight, we need determination. But sometimes life overwhelms us so much, I can't do it. And we just put aside our bow, saying, I can't fight. I quit. So Arjuna was in that situation. And from that situation, Krishna lifted him up. Now, when we are in that situation, no light, no warmth, we have to get out of it somehow or the other. It's unlivable. So now, we could go into the situation of warmth but no light, which is largely sentimental feel-good. Many people today, many of us, all of us in fact, face distress at some time or the other. And when we face distress, there are different ways in which we can come out of that distress. So there are many forms of spirituality, you could put spirituality in double quotes, where the essence is just some ways to feel good. Before I was introduced to Krishna consciousness, I was exploring various spiritual teachers. So I went to one talk and the speaker said, sit in meditation, close your eyes, imagine that you are on the banks of a river and you can feel the breeze blowing through your ears. You can hear the birds chirping, see the vast blue sky up there. You can see a hill on the other side of the river. You can see the clouds touching the top of the hill. You feel peaceful. You feel calm. You feel relaxed. And while we were going through this exercise, suddenly there was a car crash on the road. Bang! So the whole trance broke. So now, we all are agitated, and some thought exercises can make us peaceful like this. But actually, this is largely feel good. This is, we could say, psychological painkillers. There are, just said that when people are in pain, you might get physical painkillers. Where the painkillers make us feel good, but they are only covering the pain, not curing the pain. So similarly, there are many ways in which we are often offered warmth without any light, without any wisdom. Now, what is really wrong? Is there something I am doing wrong? Why are there troubles in my life? No, just visualize everything is all right and you will be all right. Entertainment, especially nowadays, escapist entertainment, it also offers us warmth without light. It just, just watch this movie, see this action, see that stunt, see that romance, see this, so that, and feel good. But how does it add any meaning or value to our life? Warmth without light, after some time, just feel good, it stops feeling good. It's like any painkiller, any pain medication, if you take it, afterward we have to take more and more and more dosage. And it just keeps increasing. So much of what goes on in the name of spirituality today is warmth but no light. It makes us feel good but doesn't really explain what is life. Why are we in distress? What is the way to come out of distress? Then there is the other side. So if we are in that state of no warmth, no light, if we go here, we can be here for some time, warmth but no light, but afterwards that starts not feeling good because it's superficial, it's a painkiller. The other could be light but no warmth, where somebody tells us the right thing, but then they do it in such a way that it's just too inaccessible, too lofty, too difficult for us. It's like if a patient is in pain and they are sick. Sometimes if a person has that severe pain, maybe a severe fracture or a severe trauma, then in such pain, even if you give a curative medicine, the body is so much reacting to the trauma that they can't take the medicine. They can't take the medicine. So they need to be given some pain medication so that their body relaxes. And after the body relaxes, then give them the proper medication. So it's like, if there's only light but no warmth, it's like a doctor doing surgery without giving anesthesia. The surgery is for good, but the pain of the surgery is so great that the patient will scream and resist and run away. So there are times when some people just think this is the thing you have to do and you must do it. If you don't do it, get lost. So I was at an interfaith conference, and there was a Christian pastor was telling, they did a survey among their youth. So what is their conception of a priest? What is the young people, how do you think of as a priest? So this one young person said that a priest is someone who is constantly worried that someone somewhere is having some fun. So their idea is that these people, they are going to tell us certain things which is going to take all the fun out of our life. So in the Bible it is said that in the beginning was the Word and the Word was God. So one another youth, he made a caricature of that. In the beginning was the Word and the Word was no. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. And this seems to be very like a life-denying kind of directive. So sometimes if we just give light but without warmth, then people simply feel alienated. Where if we just give rules, this is what you have to do and don't do this, that's all. I was in Texas, I was going for a program, and on the car in front of me, somebody had put on their car bumper that a slogan, "Oh God, please save me from your preachers." God saves us, is meant to save us through his preachers. But if the preachers are holier than thou, condescending, hell and brimstone, showering, kind of. I don't want anything to do with such people. Srila Prabhupada, in one of his talks to one of his disciples who was doing college outreach, he said, Prabhupada said that the worst thing that you can do in college outreach is to present Krishna consciousness as a set of rules. Nobody's interested in following rules. He says, rather than just telling rules, actually you need to explain how rules are routes to a better life. And once you show that, then they themselves want to follow the rules. So if we only offer the rules without an explanation for the rules, then what happens is people get alienated. So even if we tell somebody this is the right thing to do, but if they don't feel a personal connect, if they don't feel warmth, if they don't connect with us at a human level, then they will not accept. They'll just reject it and go away. And Srila Prabhupada, he was expert at doing both. I'll talk about that soon. But Krishna cautions that don't just give light without warmth. Krishna says that, for example, the austerity of speech means anudvega karam vakyam satyam priyahitam chayat swadhyaya abhyasanam chaiva vanmayam tapa uchyate. In 1716 he says, anudvega karam vakyam, speak the truth, but speak it in a way that does not agitate people's minds. It should not agitate, it should educate. So we need to speak to give people peace of mind. But often we speak to give them a peace of our mind. And that is not very helpful. So Krishna says, don't disturb the minds of uneducated, of people who are uninformed. Elevate them. Na buddhi bhedam janayet agyanam karma sanginam joshayet sarva karmani vidvan yukta samacharan. In 326 he says, even if people are attached or ignorant, don't agitate them. Educate them so that they will be gradually elevated. So before we can connect with people at a spiritual level, we need to connect with them at a human level. At a human level. At a human level, people need to feel, oh, this is nice, this is a good human, this is a nice person. Then we need to appreciate it at a human level. When Srila Prabhupada was asked about how do we identify your followers, Prabhupada said that they are perfect gentlemen, perfect ladies and perfect gentlemen. So he did not say that they wake up in the morning and chant so many rounds, or they do this worship, or they do follow these principles. The world doesn't care, you know, what time we wake up or how much meditation we do. The world actually sees how we conduct ourselves. So don't tell me what you believe, show me how you behave. So people are going to see how we conduct ourselves with them. So sometimes when we become too philosophical, then that being philosophical can actually dehumanize us. Sometimes if somebody is in great suffering, and then we go and tell them, it's your own karma because of which you are suffering. Well, that's horrible. No, I've not seen anywhere in scripture when somebody is suffering, somebody else goes and tells them, it's your karma because of which you are suffering. When Arjuna's own son Abhimanyu is killed, Krishna doesn't tell Arjuna, it was his karma or your karma because of which he was killed. Krishna is there with Arjuna to console him, to strengthen him, and to help him rise once again. Now, when somebody is suffering, we shouldn't be thinking, what is their karma? We should be thinking, what is my dharma? My dharma, what is my duty in this situation? How can I best help in this situation? If a patient is sick, the doctor is not supposed to judge, why did you become sick like this? The doctor is meant to treat. Now, as a part of the treatment, the doctor may tell that, okay, if you continue doing this, the sickness will worsen. But the doctor's primary purpose is to treat. As a part of treating, education can also be given. But the thing is that we need to make sure that we don't get so caught in giving the light that the warmth goes away completely. Srila Prabhupada says that Krishna consciousness movement is spread by the sixfold loving exchanges among the devotees. It is nourished by those sixfold loving exchanges. So these are giving gifts, receiving gifts, giving prasad, receiving prasad, and just opening our heart and speaking and being heard without being judged, and letting others open their heart and speak, and we don't judge them. We accept them, we value them, and we encourage them. So warmth is very important. And this is what is beautifully demonstrated towards the end of the Bhagavad Gita. So now I'm going to the last quadrant of, what is the last quadrant? Light and warmth both. So the Bhagavad Gita offers the light of spiritual knowledge. The Bhagavad Gita explains that we, each one of us, is a soul. We are an indestructible spiritual being, and we are on a multi-life journey of spiritual evolution. And through everything that we do, if we act in a mood of service, then we all can grow. We act in a mood of loving harmony. Wherever we are a part of a whole bigger than ourselves. And if we act in harmony with the whole, we flourish. If we act in disharmony, we perish. It's simple to understand. Say, if we go on the road, now we may have our own car and we may be having our own gas in the car, but still we are a part of the road transport system which is bigger than ourselves. And if we act harmoniously, we follow the rules, stay in the right lane, follow the signals, then we can get smoothly and safely to our destination. But if we are not a harmonious part of the whole, if we break the rules, then immediately we'll get a ticket. If we keep breaking the rules, and what happens? Our license may be taken away. We may be put in jail. So just as when we are a part of the of a road transport system which is bigger than ourselves, then we need to be in harmony. So just as that there's a whole of the bigger, there's a whole bigger than ourselves, which is a road transport system, and similarly there's a whole which encompasses the entire universe. And that whole is the ultimate reality. It's God, it's Krishna. And Krishna says, Mamaivamsho jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatana manashasthani indriyani prakriti sthani karshati. That we are all his parts and we are meant to lovingly serve him. Whatever abilities we have, whatever interests we have, whatever resources we have, we use them all in a mood of service to him. If we do this, we flourish. Otherwise, we get caught by our mind and senses, and they drag us here, there, and everywhere. The mind is such a thing that whatever we do, the mind will keep us miserable. Keep us miserable, miserable, distressed. Even if we went to paradise, the mind will say, yes, but... The mind is always habituated to looking at what we don't have and staying dissatisfied. So suppose after this program there is prasad. Well, there is no suppose, prasad is there. But suppose there is a special prasad where everybody is going to get a different dessert. So I get gulab jamun, you get son papri, you get baklava, you get, somebody gets apple pie, whatever. Now I have got a delicious dessert in my plate. But if I start looking what is in your plate and what is in her plate and what is in his plate, then I won't be able to relish what is there in my plate. Although I have a dessert, I'll be dissatisfied. So our mind is like that. No matter how much we have, the mind looks at what we don't have and keeps us dissatisfied. So to manage such a mind, we need to fix that mind first on Krishna. When we strive not to achieve, but to harmonize. Krishna, how can I serve you? And in the service of Krishna, sometimes we may get possessions, sometimes we may get various things. But it is this connection with Krishna, this harmony with Krishna, that itself will give us satisfaction. Because Krishna is the source of all happiness. He's all attractive. He's all loving. He's all joyful. And in that way, when we live in harmony with Krishna, we flourish. So this is a big subject, but the broad point is this is the light that the Bhagavad Gita offers. It's a message of live in harmony. But after giving, it's a complicated multi-level message. The philosophy of the Bhagavad Gita is profound. Toward the end of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna concludes not with light, but with warmth. So, if we look at, start from 1864. Krishna says in 1864, he's now more or less concluded his message. In 1863, he says, Arjuna, now I have completed my message. Iti te jnanam akhyatam guhyat guhyataram maya vimrishyaita dasheshena yathechasi tata kuru. I have now spoken more confidential knowledge. Now deliberate deeply and do as you desire. So here we see not a God who gives commandments. One of my friends told me that he's going, devotee friend, he said, I want to write a book on the 10 commandments of the Bhagavad Gita. I said, please don't write a book like that. Because the Bhagavad Gita's mood is not a mood of giving commandments. The Bhagavad Gita's God is not a God who sits high in the sky and gives orders. The Bhagavad Gita's God is a God who is right next to his devotee. In fact, assisting his devotee as a charioteer. The Bhagavad Gita's mood is not commandments, but choices and consequences. If you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. Now you choose what you want to do. So here we see a vision of a God who acknowledges human independence and respects human intelligence. And he appeals to that intelligence. Now you deliberate. Vimrishyaita dasheshena yathechasi tatha kuru, and do as you desire. And Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, a prominent commentator on the Bhagavad Gita, he described that at this time, Arjuna becomes deep in thought. Says, right now I'm giving a class, I'm speaking various points, all of you may have some interest. And then suddenly I ask you, so now do what you want to do. Deliberate. Hey, what's going on suddenly? What am I supposed to do? So Arjuna starts thinking, Krishna, you said this in the 5th chapter, and that's what you said in the 9th chapter, that's in the 12th chapter, this is the 16th chapter, and Arjuna becomes pensive. And seeing Arjuna becoming pensive like this, Krishna's heart overflows with compassion. And Krishna says, you know, I will tell you the conclusion. He says, in 1864, he says, Sarva guhyatamam bhuyaha shrunu me paramam vachaha ishtos me drudhamiti. He says, now I will speak the most confidential knowledge to you. Why? Because te hitam, I desire your benefit. Krishna is bearing his heart and expressing his love. He says, ishtosime drudamiti. He says, you are dearly loved by me. You are very dear to me. Krishna says, one commentator describes that, I am determined to love you. Now, the soul in the material world says, I am determined to forget you. That's how we turn away from God, but God never turns away from us. So you are very dear to me, therefore for your benefit I am speaking this. And then after that, 1865, he says, Manmana bhav madbhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mame vaishya satyam te pratijane priyosi me. So here, now this is the same instruction which Krishna has given in 934. But there is a different emphasis. In 934, he has said, Manmana bhav madbhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mame vaishya yuktvaivam atmanam matparayanaha. So there it's like, suppose we are going to maybe do a deal, sell a house to someone. And then we sell, you know, if you do this, 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 then you'll get the house. So this is, we are setting the conditions for what they have to do. That's 934, Krishna in the Bhagavata says. You do this, 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 then you'll get this. But in 1865, Krishna's compassion has become so much. Say, if we are very anxious that the person, that person take the house, then we will say, if you do this, 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 if you just do this, 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 then I guarantee you, the house will be yours. So what has happened? In 934, Krishna is focusing on what Arjuna has to do. But in 1865, Krishna is focusing on what I will do. What I will do for you. And then, 1866 is the famous verse. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma shuchaha. So he says, if you feel that somehow you might have done something wrong or you're doing something wrong and some reactions, sinful reactions come because of that, he says, I will protect you from it all. Ma shuchaha, do not fear. Krishna is giving an assurance. So, if you consider 729 or 727, 28, 29, there Krishna has first said that, before you become devoted to me, you have to become free from all sin. Yesham tvantagatam papam jananam punya karmanam te dvandva moha nirmukta bhajante mam dridavrata. He says, become free from sin, then you can practice my bhakti determinedly. But here Krishna is saying, just even if you are sinful, just surrender, I will free you from sin. So the example is given for this. Say, you know, there's a loving mother and the mother is training her child, you know, to be clean, say potty training. And then the child, the mother warns the child, you know, if you dirty yourself, don't come to me before you clean yourself. And then the child again maybe dirties himself. And then the mother is saying, don't come to me before you clean yourself. And the child just, I'm helpless, I don't know how to clean myself. And the mother says, come, I'll clean you. So Krishna's mood in 727 is, first clean yourself, then come to me. But in 1866, just come here, I'll clean you. So that, he says, Krishna says, no hesitating, just come to me. And then after that, Krishna gives the Falashruti. He says, in 1867, he says that this knowledge is very, very rare treasure, but I have given it to you. Handle it carefully. And then he offers a rope of mercy. He says, if you share this message, you will become the most dear to me. Yaidam paramam guhyam madbhakteshu vidasyati bhaktim mai param krutva mame vaishyatya samshayah. You just share this message with others, you will become most dear to me and you will attain me. Somebody may say, oh my God, sharing the Bhagavad Gita message is very, very difficult. I can't do it. And Krishna says, if you can't do it, you just study the message. He says, Adeshyate cha yaimam dharmyam samvadamavayo jnana yagyena tenaham ishtasyamiti mehmatihi. If you just study this, then don't think the study is simply intellectual. He says, if you're studying this message, then you are worshipping me with your intelligence. Just like we may worship the Lord with a lamp, you are worshipping me with your intelligence. So to envision what is going on over here, there's somebody has fallen in a well. And a person from outside says, here I'm going to throw a rope out to you. You just hold on to the rope and I'll pull you out. But the person says, oh no, if I have to hold on to the rope, my whole body's weight will come on my arms and my arms will pain. I can't hold on. And that person takes a rope, makes it with a lasso, ties it, and he says, sends it down. He says, just tie it around your waist, I will pull you out. And the person says, no, no, no. But if you tie it around my waist, it will pain me in my waist so much. So similarly, if somebody says, I can't even study the Bhagavad Gita, then Krishna says, if you can't study, just hear the Bhagavad Gita. Hear, just hear the Bhagavad Gita. If you hear it, what will happen? You will become purified. You will become elevated. You will attain an auspicious destination. That's like the person outside the well says, okay, now I will tie a bucket to a rope and send it down. You just sit in the bucket and I'll pull you out. So, unfortunate, so Krishna is offering us that. He says, just hear and you will become purified and liberated. But when the bucket is being pulled up, we are expert at overturning the bucket and falling down again. Sometimes, we are our worst enemies. We sometimes say, why is God not helping me? But the bigger question should be, why am I not helping myself? We often do things which sabotage ourselves. But Krishna is so loving. He's saying, Arjuna, I love you, I care for you, and I am ready to do anything for you. You just do your part and I will do everything else. And then the last verse that Krishna speaks in the Bhagavad Gita is 1872, where he says, Kachideta shrutam partha tvaye kagrena chetasa kachidagyana sammoha prashtaste dhananjaya. Says, oh Arjuna, have you heard attentively? Has your illusion and ignorance been dispelled? So the Gita commentators, Vishwanath Thakur, explains that Krishna is so concerned that Arjuna understand properly. That if Arjuna has not understood something, Krishna is saying, I am ready to repeat that part to you. I am ready to repeat the whole Gita to you. I just want to make sure that you understand it. And the last word that Krishna speaks in the Bhagavad Gita is Dhananjaya. Kachidagyana sammoha pranashtaste Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya is winner of wealth. So Krishna is asking Arjuna, oh Arjuna, have you, by hearing the Bhagavad Gita, won the wealth of wisdom? Have you become enriched with wisdom? The Bhagavad Gita wants to make all of us rich. Rich with the wisdom of how to live our life effectively. And Krishna is concerned, oh Arjuna, have you become enriched? And this is Krishna's love overflowing through his heart. So Krishna has offered the light, but he is concluding by offering warmth. And what is the result? Arjuna says that, yes, I am ready. Karishye vachanam tava. I will do your will. So Krishna, at the end of the Bhagavad Gita, is described, last verses, yatra yogeshwara krishno, yatra partho dhanurdharaha. Arjuna has picked up his bow in readiness to fight. So that same bow which he had put down, he has now picked up. Similarly, if we study the Bhagavad Gita and understand its message of light and warmth, both, then no matter how discouraged we might be, we will be able to raise our bow. Our determination will come back. We all have big problems in life. But God is bigger than the biggest problems that we may face. The world can hurt us in many ways. But greater than the world's power to hurt is God's power to heal. Greater than the world's power to hurt is God's power to heal. And instead of turning to the world and resenting, why is it hurting us so much? We turn towards God and open our head and heart to His wisdom and His love, to His light and His warmth. And whatever situation we may be in, we will be uplifted. We will be enriched. We will be protected. We will be strengthened. And ultimately, we will be liberated. This is the message of the Bhagavad Gita. And when Srila Prabhupada came 50 years ago here to the West and then across the world, he also offered both the light and the warmth. Through his books, if you only read his books, we will get the light. But we won't understand the full Srila Prabhupada. But to read books like Lilamrut, which describe Prabhupada's life, how he dealt so lovingly with devotees. With everybody who came, they felt touched and enlivened by Prabhupada's kindness. Prabhupada was a great saint, but Prabhupada was also a caring human being. In fact, his care was a part of his spiritual compassion. And as whoever came to him, Prabhupada touched their hearts. And it was not just the light that attracted them, it was the warmth that attracted them. And when we learn to both ourselves experience the light and warmth coming from Krishna through his scriptures and through his devotees, and when we share that light and warmth with each other and with others who are coming to Krishna, then we'll find that we all can become enriched, not just with our devotional connection with Krishna, but also with our devotional connections with others. Srila Prabhupada said that the Krishna consciousness movement is meant to bring human beings closer to each other and closer to Krishna. So we do both when we share light and warmth. I'll conclude with one incident from Srila Prabhupada's life, and then we can have a few comments or questions. Once the devotees here in America had a small center. It was like an apartment. Now we call it apartment, but most apartments are not apart. They are very close to each other. So the devotees were in one apartment, and on the other apartment there was an old lady who was staying. And this old lady was, she said these devotees are so noisy, and they were young, and they were just hippies who had become devotees. So she was complaining against them, and because of that, local municipal authorities were also opposing the devotees. And when Prabhupada came there, and when Prabhupada came, at that time, the devotees complained, and this lady is opposing us so much. Sometimes devotees can become too simplistic to the point of being insensitive. Anybody who opposes devotion, that person is a demon. So Prabhupada, this lady is a demon. They had gone for a walk, and when they came back, Prabhupada, instead of going to this side of the apartment where the devotees are, they went to that lady's side. And he knocked on the door. And when she opened the door, Prabhupada just started talking with her. And it's like a typical old people talk. So how are you? How is your health? How is your family? Where are your children? What are they doing? And almost 15-20 minutes, Prabhupada was talking with her. And after that, they had a very cordial discussion, and Prabhupada departed. And when they parted, the devotees had a big question mark on their face. Prabhupada did not speak one word about Krishna to her. Prabhupada did not preach to her. And Prabhupada sensed what the devotees were thinking, and Prabhupada said, sometimes old people feel lonely. Old people get lonely. And when they get lonely, they become irritable. They become irritable. And that's all Prabhupada spoke. And then Prabhupada left. And then the next day, when the devotees were going out, this old lady was coming from a walk. And she said, your Swami is such a nice person. And then she withdrew all the complaints she had about the devotees. So Prabhupada brought this lady closer to Krishna without speaking one word about Krishna. So Prabhupada, it was by the warmth, not by the light. It's not to minimize the light, but to recognize the importance of the warmth. So when we learn from Srila Prabhupada and from Krishna how to bring in the light and the warmth, then we all can become agents of compassion, of kindness, of spiritual love. And we can come closer to Krishna, and we can bring others closer to Krishna. The festival of lights, Diwali, is going to come. Even the festival of Damodar, where we offer lights to Krishna. This is a festival of light and love. Krishna is revealing the spiritual world. But he's revealing the spiritual world where he is an intimate divinity, where he is fearful of his mother. He's so much filled with, he's so eager for the love of his mother that he is ready to become a small child who gets bound. So this is the tradition of bhakti, a tradition of light and a tradition of warmth. And both of them, when combined together, can empower us and empower others to bring out the best within ourselves, to bring out the divinity within ourselves, and to make the world a brighter and a better place. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on the theme of how the Bhagavad Gita offers spiritual love through light and warmth. Talk about the four quadrants. No light, no warmth is a terrible place to be in, where we don't know what to do, and we feel nobody cares for us. We feel terrible also. So most people seek a way out by warmth but no light. That could be shallow forms of spirituality which just make us feel good, or it could just be mindless entertainment in which we escape. This is like a painkiller. And it is a psychological painkiller which can't have much long-term good. And you need more and more doses after some time. And then the other is, we give light but no warmth. That's like doing surgery without anesthesia. We give rules, we hand out judgments, and people just feel alienated, discouraged, and then they go away. So we need to offer both light and warmth. I talked about how in the conclusion of the Bhagavad Gita, after Krishna has offered light, how we need to live in harmony with the whole. He says we need to drive in traffic according to the rules. We need to live in harmony with the whole. That is ultimate reality is Krishna. He gives that message, but then he concludes with warmth. Krishna opens his heart and says, I care for you. I will protect you from all sinful reactions. Only for your benefit I am speaking. And he says, he gives multiple options. You pray, you share my message. If you can't do that, hear my message. You study my message. If you can't study my message, hear my message. It's like offering a rope and pulling a person out by tying it, or offering a bucket. Krishna is offering more and more compassion. And Krishna says that, oh Arjuna, are you enriched with wisdom? And we see Krishna, the Bhagavad Gita takes Arjuna from the place where he was no light, no warmth. Arjuna was in no man's land, in between the two armies and confused. From there, Krishna takes him to light and warmth. So Arjuna, who had put aside his bow, picks up his bow in readiness to fight. And that bow also represents our determination to face life's adversities. But we may lose heart, but by understanding the Bhagavad Gita's message of love, we all can gain heart and pick up our bow. Srila Prabhupada offered the light of spiritual wisdom, but he also offered the warmth of kindness, of human compassion, of human connections. And that's how he elevated and transformed everyone. And when we all can receive and share this light and warmth, we can make our heart a brighter and better place, and each of us can help make the world a brighter and better place. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Are there any questions? We have a few minutes. Yes, please.
You know, like in Tamil language, there is a saying like, do good to those who hurt us. Basically, if someone hurt us, we should do good. Mm. Is it practically possible?
Okay. So can we do good to others if they hurt us? See, there is a difference between kindness and foolishness. Kindness and foolishness. We always want to be kind to others. But we have to see whether our kindness is benefiting anyone or is simply empowering those who are out to hurt us. So we see Krishna tells Arjuna that do not treat anyone as an enemy. Nirvairaha sarva bhuteshu. Do not have enmity towards anyone. But that is 1155 in the Bhagavad Gita. But 22 verses earlier, 1133, Krishna is telling Arjuna, fight, and by my arrangement your enemies are killed. So Krishna is saying, you may have to fight against someone, but you don't have to be against someone. Means circumstantially, if somebody is hurting us, we may have to be assertive at that time. But we don't have to have like a personal enmity towards them. So broadly, we could say that there are three options. See, there in general, it is good to be forgiving. It's okay, somebody has incidentally hurt us, then don't hold grudges against them. So forgiveness is good, but we have to see that if somebody repeatedly hurts us, then we have to be careful. There is a difference between forgiving and trusting. Forgiveness is for the past. Trust is for the future. Say if we give some money to someone and they lost it, and then they say, please give me more money. Well, we may forgive them for what they've lost, but again if we give them, it's foolish, they will again lose it. So forgiveness can and should be given, but trust needs to be earned. So usually if somebody hurts us, we can forgive but withhold trust. And then, now that withhold trust is not out of anger, it is also about kindness. Sometimes somebody is doing something wrong, if they are allowed to go on that way, they will do more and more wrong. So sometimes they may rectify themselves. If they rectify themselves, then we can give them trust also. But sometimes they may just keep doing wrong. Then in that case, in spirit, we can still be forgiving. But in action, sometimes we may have to seek justice. So the Pandavas, they had nothing personally against the Kauravas. But the Kauravas were demoniac, vicious. And they were ready to dishonor honorable lady in public. Not just in public, in a royal assembly. That is the place where justice is to be given. See, if somebody molests a woman, normally people do it in a private place or nobody will catch. But if somebody does it in a public place, that's brazen. If somebody does that in the court, that means how brazen is somebody like that? And the Kauravas were like that. And if they acquired power, untrammeled power, unchallenged power, they would wreak havoc in society. So Krishna said, you have to be strong, you have to be assertive against them. But don't need to hold a personal enmity. So be kind, but kindness can have different forms. Sometimes kindness can be just forgiving and forgetting. Sometimes kindness can be forgiving, but also seeking justice so that they are restrained. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, please. There, behind.
Thank you, Prabhu. Amazing class, as usual. My question is, what is the relationship between tapasya? Because, you know, we read in Prabhupada's books that human life is meant for tapasya, voluntarily accepting inconvenience to the body and the mind for the purpose of making spiritual advancement. So, so what's the relationship between that and being in the zone or the quadrant where there's light and warmth? In other words, I'm not saying you're saying anything wrong, but okay. I'm making it sound as if if spiritual life's going right, we're going to experience both light and warmth. But that's very attractive, and I like that. But it seems to me that it could be a misconception that I have. Upon reading Prabhupada's books, that you have to go through a certain amount of no warmth and just light, tapasya, and to get to that quadrant of the light and the warmth. You understand the question? Yeah. Okay, yeah.
So, now we can, if we practice spiritual life, we'll be in that zone of light and warmth always. Our austerity means that we may have to live in the light even if there is no warmth. Yes, definitely that is true. See, it depends on how, from what perspective we are looking at it. Say, another example could be that we are all told to cultivate humility. But at the same time, it is said, amanina manadena. We are also told to be respectful to others. Now, if I speak harshly, judgmentally, I insult others, somebody, and say, I am helping you become humble. Well, that it is for me to make myself humble. I don't have to have the self-appointed agenda to make somebody else humble. So, with respect to others, we should be respectful. And for ourselves, we cultivate humility. So similarly, with respect to others, we try to give both light and warmth. But to some extent, for ourselves, we may not always get the warmth. So we need to accept that. We will go through those phases. There will be austerities when we may feel ununderstood. We may feel lonely, we may feel rejected, suspected. So many things can happen in the world. The worst loneliness is not when we are alone. The worst loneliness is when we are surrounded by people who don't understand us. And sometimes that can happen for all of us. So when that happens, we have to see that this is austerity I have to pursue. I have to persevere through this. But broadly speaking, we need to create a community where everybody normally gets light and warmth. It's like austerity is required. But say, we fast on certain days. We fast on certain holy days, Ekadashi and others. But we also make proper arrangements so that on other days, at proper timings, food is available. So if every day when we wake up, there is worry, will I get food or not? Then that's not austerity, that's simply anxiety. So, in an overall life of stability, occasional periods of deprivation is what austerity is about. But when there is constant deprivation, then it becomes very difficult to be stable. It becomes very stable, very difficult to sustain ourselves. So yes, we all need to do austerity, but even austerity has to be done in a way that is sustainable. So sometimes it may be extreme austerities. So sometimes we may be in a situation where we are, nobody understands us, people are criticizing us, and we have to persevere in our devotion. But if that is the way we are constantly in our spiritual life, then that will be unbearable. So we need to have light and warmth, and we need to share light and warmth. At the same time, we need to be ready that there are times when warmth may not be there. Sometimes there may be time when light is also not there. We just don't know, what am I to do in this situation? So we need to just do our best and take small steps and move on, praying to Krishna for guidance. So austerity is something which is required, but it should not be so much that it breaks us down. It should be just something which just extends us so that we can come out of our comfort zone. Okay? Thank you. So, do we have time or? Okay, one last question is.
So, if this loneliness, if the loneliness overwhelms us, or we see it in others, in another, how can we break out of it?
Okay,
it may be very difficult.
If the loneliness overcomes us, then how do we break out of it, or how do we help someone else break out of it? So generally, when loneliness comes in somebody's life, it is primarily because that, as I said, they're surrounded by people who don't understand them, or they don't understand others. So now, at that time, someone has to give way. So, guhyam akhyati pruchyati. There has to be someone whom we share our heart with. See, generally, because life is tough, and we may be exploited by others, we have that fear. So all of us put on a front, where we hide our insecurities, hide our doubts, hide our fears, hide our desires. And to some extent, that's required in life. We have to put on a front. But sometimes, you know, the heaviest burden that we can bear is not what on the back, but it's on the face. It's a mask. So we need to sometimes admit vulnerability. That means we put down our mask and share. You know, I'm facing this difficulty with someone. It's like when we enter into a water body for swimming. First we just put our toes in it to see how cold it is. So we might share a little bit with someone who we feel is understanding, and then we see how they respond. Hey, you think like this? How can you think like this? I thought you're an advanced devotee. How can a devotee think like this? If they start becoming judgmental, then we decide, oh, this is not the place where I can open myself. So we need to take the steps. See, at one level, maturity means to understand that no one is obliged to fulfill our needs. When a baby is small, the baby cries and the world runs to feed the baby. But an adult, the adult may be hungry and the adult starts crying, nobody may come to feed. That doesn't mean the adult's hunger is not real. It's real and it's essential to have food. But the adult has to go and make arrangements. Maturity means understanding that no one is obliged to fulfill my needs. So if I have a need, I have to make the arrangement to fulfill it. So if I am feeling lonely, then I have to take the steps forward. Maybe lower my guard, express a vulnerability a little bit. It may work with one person, it may not work with another person. And wherever it works, we put in some effort and we try to connect. Sometimes we may have superficial connections with many people and no deep connection with anyone. And sometimes we may have to decide that, okay, superficial connections, stop it for some time and focus on deeply connecting with one or two human beings. So, you know, it is easier to love humanity than to love one human being. Humanity, the abstract. I'm compassionate towards all humanity. Well, it's just a statement you make. We don't have to make any sacrifice. But when we have to love one human being, sometimes they ask us something, and then we have to get out of our comfort zone to do it for them. It's difficult. So trying to do what it takes to develop a connection with one or two people, that's very helpful. And then gradually, that loneliness will start decreasing. And if somebody is to extend themselves to us, we need to reciprocate. If somebody is ready to talk with us, spend time with us, ask us, then we start reciprocating. So gradually, we will find that with some people, the connections will work. We need to put in that effort. Does that answer your question? So thank you very much. Shila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande. Just a quick announcement. I have written about 20 books. So out of which a few books are here. This is Gita Wisdom Through Quotes. There are 365 quotes inspired by the Bhagavad Gita. Like I spoke, greater than the world's power to hurt is God's power to heal. So like that, there are 365 quotes. And this is Wisdom from Ramayana on Life and Relationships. There are 20 essays, 20 articles in the Ramayana, which are explained here along with life lessons. You know, when bad things happen to good people, how do they respond? What do good people do? So when Ram was exiled, he accepted that as destiny. When Sita was abducted, he didn't accept that as destiny. So what is destiny? What does it control? What does it not control? And the most perplexing question from the Ramayana, after winning the war, why did Ram send Sita away? All that is answered in this book. And the same wisdom cards are wisdom quotes from the Bhagavad Gita are available as a card deck. There's 365 quotes. They can be put on an easel that is there inside. And you can keep this in your office. And you can non-intrusive way of presenting spiritual wisdom to your colleagues. You can also use this as a tarot card or a fortune cookie. Just take out a card when you have some guests coming and see what does the Bhagavad Gita say for you. So these are available here. So they are available in case you want it. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.